obviously, you know, from my standpoint and from the team standpoint, we've had a tough summer, period. In this league, you don't have an opportunity at times for do-overs. And when you get a chance to win, as we have had in the past, you know, 2006, 11 and 12, you know, when you get a chance to win, you got to win. And when you get an opportunity this summer to do something that you could have done, you didn't do it, you didn't do it. And so 1995 or 96, I was put in charge of basketball operations. And I've always taken the approach that there were about five things that I really valued. And they're not my words, they're somebody else's words, you know, because I get educated by other people, but is to, you know, be impeccable with your word, you know, to never take anything personal, don't make any assumptions, always do your best, be skeptical, but learn to listen. And this summer, at least three of those things didn't come to fruition, so... what happened with Dwyane floored me, and I'm going to miss the fact of what I might have had planned for him and his future and how I saw the end and my thought process and how I could see his end here with the Heat. You are what you think, and you are your thoughts, and it's my responsibility to sort of make that happen. I didn't make it happen, and Dwyane left, and so the buck really stops here. I'm not trying to fall on the sword for anybody. I have great regret that I didn't put myself in the middle of it and immerse myself totally in the middle of it. Get in a canoe and paddle to the Mediterranean if I had to. You know, be in New York when he arrived on the 6th and greet him at the airport. I didn't do that. I wasn't there in the middle of that negotiation, and that's my job. And so it's not going to be the same without him. But we will, you know, forge ahead. I've been here when Zoe left, been here when Shaq left, been here when LJ left, you know, Brian Grant, Eddie Jones, but Dwyane is unique. And as I think Mike and our marketing department, you know, have done such a great job, you know, there'll always be a key under the mat. I just hope it doesn't get too rusty, that's all, you know, from that standpoint, and I'm going to miss him. But anyways, I'll open it up to questions, because I know that you've had a lot of things, you know, that you've been kicking around, so I'm free to answer anything.
Pat, can you fill us in a little on where the situation with Chris Bosh stands, and if he does not have another or did not have another recurrence with blood clots, will he be returning today on July 16th? What would you say the percentages are of Chris Bosh being a member of the Heat's active roster in 16-17?
It's always fluid, and it has been since there was a diagnosis and a decision for him not to play for the rest of the season. You know, what the standard of care is in that situation is what drove us to make that decision. It's a positive environment right now with Chris, and I think his doctors, our doctors are constantly or more so now than ever, communicating. I know what Chris wants, and I know he wants to play, and obviously we would be open to that, but this is still a very fluid situation. There's no, on this day today, you said it's today the 15th or the 16th? Already? Okay, this is the 16th. There's not an answer, Ira. I wish I could give you one. And so let's just let this process, you know, move on down the road, and then we'll go from there.
Pat, when you talk about regret and how if you had been in New York, if you had taken the canoe to the Mediterranean, whatever the opportunity was, why didn't that happen? And did you almost get urged in some ways by Dwayne's side to stay away and kind of let things play out the way they did?
We've always operated on the premise of a single voice, you know, not mine, you know, but Mickey, myself, Nick, you know, Andy, you know, Eric Woolworth, you know, Mike McCullough. I mean, one single voice. I mean, there's two entities here. You know, when it comes to basketball operations, we've always talked about the one voice, which is a philosophy and a plan, and moving on down the line that we all that's what we are and that's what we believe in. And so there was one voice in this negotiation. There are some times that Andy, you know, handles an agent and a player, and Andy complete the deal. You know, there are times that I've done most of them, you know, and complete the deal. There are times when you have a long-standing relationship with a player, you know, like Dwayne or Udonis, you know, or even at the time I remember with Alonzo, that sometimes the owner gets involved in it. But we all speak with one voice. We all know what we want to do and what we want to accomplish. And so, I mean, the thing that happens during the course of negotiations, you know, over the course of 7 or 8 days, has to do a lot with your thought process as to what the conditions were prior to that. And the conditions prior to that over the last year or two have always sort of pointed in the direction that, you know, we as an organization didn't do enough, you know, for Dwayne. And I've always been one who was reaching to get him another guy, especially, you know, after LJ left, and trying to find a way to get him another guy to help him not only win, but to help him win in a way that he would be very proud when he moved on out and retired. You know, and so it wasn't just getting another guy for him. It was to maximize our ability to win. And the only way we can do that is to have cooperation, is to the same kind of collaborative cooperation they had in 2010, you know, and how that whole thing came together. And I don't think it's a coincidence that if you go back to those 4 years, where every single player came in because they wanted to be here, and they were the ones that were given it back, that we went to the finals 4 times and we won 2 world championships, and then it changed. And in the summer of, you know, 2014, the whole thing got turned over. And sometimes, you know, the carnage that is left out there, you got to try to pick up the pieces, but at the same time fill in the holes to be competitive, you know, getting Lou Deng, getting McRoberts, and, you know, at that time, and trying to forge forward. But so what my thoughts were always to try to make the team better, and also at the same time to try to, you know, make sure that Dwayne, you know, over the course of the 3, 4, 5 years that he had left in his career, that he was going to get his money, that he would get it. But not at the expense of paralyzing, you know, our ability to win. And which I think would have hurt him, you know. So, you know, if there's anything that I could have done better, as I said, I would have done it. But right now, there's no do-overs in this thing. And, you know, I wish him the best. It's been a sad week for both Chris and I. You know, we love him dearly. And Gabby and the family. And, you know, just there's nothing you can say about it. I've always said that, you know, one of the only things you can count on in life that's permanent, it's one of my favorite sayings, is change. And when change raises its beautiful or ugly face, you got to deal with it. And you got to adapt and move on. We've been here before, and so I do. I wish him nothing but the best and nothing but great health. And, you know, and I do think we sort of gathered ourselves a little bit at the end, and during this process, while we were negotiating with his agents, we were talking to all of these other players, and the possibility that if something were to happen, that we could be able to move quickly. During that time, from July 1st to the 3rd, there are only two players. I think there are only two players that we felt that if we knew this was going to happen, that we sort of regretted that they went off the board. But that's the game that you play when it's free agency. Yes, sir.
Pat, just going back to Dwyane for a second, how would you characterize your guys' relationship now, and have you guys been able to speak since he decided?
No, I haven't spoken to Dwyane yet. I've been crafting a very long email to him, and I'm going to send it when it's finished, but it's not finished. As far as I'm concerned, if I saw him right now, I really believe that there it'd be a warm embrace. You know, I don't have any of those feelings, you know, any negative feelings for him at all. You know, I know that he was caught in a quandary with his thinking and his thought processes at the time and what he felt was going on, and I know I was locked into mine, you know, at that time, and so that's what happened. But I think, and I was so impressed, you know, when he talked to you guys the day after, and I really believe he was sincere, truly sincere in the things that he said. At that particular time, you know, he was raw, and I feel the same way about him. You know, we all do, and I think everybody in the organization will feel that way about him forever.
Pat, just going back to Chris Bosch for a second, is it simply a matter of him being free of the blood clots, or is it a much more complicated issue than that with him returning to the court next season?
You know, I can't speak medically about this thing. I can only speak from a basketball standpoint, and that he's going to, he's been working out, and that he's going to probably continue to work out. And so from a basketball standpoint, is it complicated? It's only complicated based on the information that we would get back from our doctors if there's ever a moment of truth, you know, when it comes to, you know, yes or no. But from the standpoint as of today, it's moving forward in a position of in down that road of him playing, that he wants to play, and we're open to helping him. We're open to helping him get there. That's all I can say. You know, it's a sensitive, complicated situation that I can't really speak to medically. You know, from a basketball standpoint, I've been told, been sort of put on hold here, but we know what Chris is capable of, and you know, the last 2 years, you know, losing him after the All-Star break both years in a row, you just never know what you have or what you could have done, you know, from that standpoint as a team. And so that's what kills me, is that we put together a good team right after you know, LJ left, and but we never had the opportunity to see it at its full. So I think we should just wait till, you know, August, you know, September. I think we'll have a lot more information then.
Pat, you mentioned it's been a tough summer personnel-wise. What's your plan for getting this roster back up to your standards, and how quickly do you think that's possible?
Well, as I said, you know, when I left, you know, after the season, in the season-ending press conference, that, you know, Chris is an X factor here. So he's an X factor. We'll find out. That would you know, make the whole thing a lot easier. I also said the priority at that time, not being the priority, not the priority, I said a priority, was Hassan Whiteside. And there's no doubt that I was going to meet and talk with him early and get him signed. The fact that Hassan and Justice and Josh and Tyler are all like in that young group of guys, if you want to, we can debate it. Give me four guys their age in the league, and let's play a four-on-four game, and I think we'd have a pretty competitive four, whether they're lottery picks or not. You know, and so we feel that we have a good base of young players. And so now the next step is to see what they can do and to augment this team, and then go from here. We are definitely going to be young. We're going to be playing at probably a different pace next year. What player emerges as sort of the guy, only time will tell. And I think that's a great part about, being in my position, is that once you give somebody the responsibility and you say, okay, hey, here it is, man. We push you through the door. I mean, you always talk about this in the locker room, or you think you can start, or you can play 30 minutes, or you want the ball in the last 3 minutes of the game, then here's your opportunity. And I think we have a couple of guys that are ready for that. I think Goran is going to have a different kind of season, a different kind of responsibility. We'll see what happens with him from that standpoint. Justice, Winslow, we've always sort of looked at him at it's time. I remember when James Worthy, came to the Lakers, and Jamal Wilkes was the incumbent. And then there came that time. There came that time when it was just a matter of time before James Worthy, was going to take his position. So are we ready for Justice Winslow to start at the three? I am. I'm not just throwing him out there. This guy has been thrown out there last year and played significant minutes and significant times. I trust him. So you guys put too much emphasis on the things that he can't do versus what he can. And those things that he can't do, he's going to be able to do better with more minutes.
Pat, obviously the offer that you made to Dwyane would have tied up considerable cap space the next 2 years. Tyler's offer sheet would not have. That being said, what was your thinking in not offering Dwyane a third year but committing to Tyler at such a huge number that might reduce flexibility in years 3 and 4 at $19 and $20 million?
Well, if you're rolling over year to year and you're looking at the free agent class, then having your best and most important player at a time in his career, he's 35 years old, having him on a 1-1, on a 2-year deal, on a 1-1, so if he does opt out, then obviously the next year, if there's people out there in the market that you want that could come in under, and then you have that flexibility versus being locked into a 3-year deal where you don't. Now, he could opt out, and if you miss on somebody, then because he's got bird rights, bird rights is the golden pass here for any veteran players. So you don't have to give players, 20-20-20-20. You can give them 20-8-37-25. What difference does it make? I mean, it's just, and we never talked about that, but I'm sure that that's probably, if there was a player that Dwyane really likes it, heck yes. If there's a free agent that can come in here. That was the partnership that we had, not with him, but that's the partnership that the players had with the big three. And there's a very cooperative, collaborative, what is it going to take to get players in to help us win? And so that's where, I kept reaching, and probably that's where I missed the point with him. And if I had a chance to really sit down and rethink my thoughts patiently at that time, maybe I could have made a difference in explaining the big picture versus the now picture.
With regard to Tyler, as part of that, why the commitment? Why was there comfort?
Well, he's on it. Well, it's a distorted contract, so he's on it low numbers the next 2 years. So, and then we'll have to deal with the, with what's in year 3 and 4. So, and the reason why we matched is because, when you have a restricted free agent, or he wasn't a restricted free agent, but he was a player that, under the Gilbert Arena rules, makes it very difficult for you, makes it easy for somebody like Brooklyn, who tried to get a bunch of young guys, balloon them up, and so to tell us that, we're going to poach one of your guys, Mickey said, you're not poaching any of my guys. And, Mickey made the decision. He loves Tyler. He's a young piece. Part of our future, and so we'll deal with years 3 and 4, but years 1 and 2, we got them at a bargain.
Have you envisioned a situation with Chris maybe playing with a restricted travel or maybe a limited workload?
I think all those things will come in to play, and there will be a discussion. There are many players in different sports that do play with that condition, and they're on and off programs on blood thinners and stuff. But I think when it comes down to a final protocol or if it gets to a formula in how this has to be done, then that's what we'll deal with.
Pat, do you have any idea how it got here? I mean, it wasn't... I know Dwyane talked about money and respect levels and things of that nature, but in the end of the day, 42 here versus 47 in Illinois, it kind of works out tax-wise to roughly the same number. So it couldn't have been just money. It couldn't have been just one thing. Do you know what the ultimate deciding factor was?
You know, you get to a point, I think, as a man in your life where your thinking and thought process change. And they change on the circumstances, they change on the present moment, they change on the future, they change on what's going on, and or you get locked into them. And so I keep talking about how he was thinking, I think, and how I was thinking at the time. And so, but you are what your thoughts are, and if his thoughts are where he was at that point where money wasn't the issue, then it was something else. And then, you know, that is where we both failed then. You know, this was not about money. This was about something else. And I more than he, because, you know, he's the asset. He's the star. He's the face of the franchise. I should have tried to done everything that I could have verbally in trying to change his mindset to mine, or a big picture, or a better picture, or one that I thought would help him, and also would give him two things: would help him end his career, and also get him, I think, financially, the money that he needed and wanted.
Pat, obviously, you made a huge commitment to Hassan Whiteside, a player with limited experience, to a degree, limited productivity, played off the bench second half of the season. What made you go out and feel comfortable enough to give pretty close to maximum money going forward to a player like that? And was there ever a point, just the magnitude of the deal, when you had to sit back a little bit and realize the sort of commitment, such a long term, to a player who is a relative neophyte in this league?
Different world we're in the NBA, Ira. You've been covering it for 29 years. We've only been here 28. How can you cover it for 29?
Well, we're going into
29. Oh, I got you. Okay. So, but so you've seen the changes over the years. So all of us have been around all these years, have seen how the things have changed. I mean, when I was coaching the Lakers, I remember Jerry West calling me on the phone in my first year and saying, "We just signed Mitch Kupchak." Now, he was the first free agent to ever sign a free agent contract. He signed for like $1,800,000, you know, $600,000 a year for 3 years. And so I said, what do we have to give up for him? He said, nothing. He's a free agent, you know. And so Mitch Kupchak came to the Lakers, and at $600,000, he's making, I think, twice the money of Kareem and twice the money of Magic and, you know, all these players. And so, you know, we've seen this whole thing change over the years dramatically, and this summer there was an explosion, an absolute explosion of dollars and the amount of money that came into the system because of the television contract and the cap going from $70 to $94 million. That's an added $24 million. I've never seen more teams with more maximum room than I've seen this year. So there are a lot of opportunities for players to really capitalize. I don't look at that with Hassan. What I look at with Hassan is that we were very fortunate to get him. But we did track him, and, you know, he was on our radar, and we ended up getting him here. And we saw enough in the last 2 years to say that this is a very unique talent, very unique player. And at the dollars that he's going to be getting over the 4 years, we felt that it was worth the investment. You've all seen him play, and he can absolutely dominate a game. And on the defensive end, blocking shots, rebounding, lobs, dunks, all those things. But I wouldn't judge him and warn him. Don't warn him, please. You know, you shouldn't do this just because, you know, the guy got a max contract. don't warn him that you better play well, or we're going to tell everybody you're not deserving of the money. I mean, if you take a look at some of the contracts that went out the first 2 days, on December the 15th, Andy and I are going to be getting a lot of calls from teams about how to get rid of those deals. And so we believe he's an essential part of this team, anchors our defense, will improve offensively, and gain more confidence. So we agreed, you know, as an organization that he was a player that we're willing to make that investment in. I don't think he's a neophyte. Neophytes don't, you know, get 20 rebounds and 20 points and block 12 shots. He is a little bit young and raw to a leadership role and a responsible every single night role. You got to produce these numbers. That's what our obligation is as a franchise, as coaches, to make sure he's productive. You know, but the money doesn't have anything to do with it. No, it's not an impediment. It's just something that has to run its course, you know. We went through it with Alonzo Mourning, so we know at that time, you know, what happened with the team, and we're going through it right now with Chris. And so it's a factor that we have to weigh on a regular basis, but because it's an unknown to some extent, it will work itself out. But it does right now stymie us from doing certain things, and instead of knowing wholeheartedly that, you know, he's going to be at the four spot next year.
Pat, if you'd be kind enough just to go over each one of the threes and fours, so you add what you liked about each of them, and Babbitt and James Johnson, Derek Williams, and then your five and Willie Reed.
You want me to talk about all 17 players or just?
Well, those four.
Okay. Some of the first conversations we had, you know, with Derek Williams' agent, you know, James Johnson's, you know, agent. We always liked Luke. You know, Babbitt, you know, from years past, and we just didn't think he was in sort of maybe the right situation. But last year we felt that he played extremely well in New Orleans. And Willie Reed, we knew. We had him. We thought he had a good year last year with, you know, with Brooklyn. And so, you know, filling positions in right now with a lot of new players. And of course, with Wayne Ellington, having him come in as a player that's, you know, personally, that we know he can shoot the ball. And, you know, we felt very good about being able to go after these players, and especially getting them on one-year contracts. And at the same time, you know, having a very young athletic team and then still being in the game next summer.
Skill set specifically with Williams. Obviously, you're getting defense with Williams and James Johnson. What appealed to his skill set?
Well, this new word, from a skill set standpoint, you know, James Johnson is a defender. He's 6'9". He's very athletic, very long. I've seen him have great games. I mean, truly great games. He started for Toronto a number of games before he rolled his ankle over, and then the young kid from UCLA came in and took a lot of his minutes. But I think with consistent minutes and, you know, with a specific role as a sort of a Swiss Army knife type of guy, he's 6'9" and guard guys. He can really defend. And I think if you're looking to beat anybody in the East, then you have to look at how you're going to be defending certain players that can make the difference. Williams, you know, from that standpoint, Derek Williams is an elite athlete above and beyond, you know, from an athletic standpoint, and we think we can raise his 30%, you know, three-point shooting to maybe 37 or 38. We feel like we can do that, that we can improve that. We can improve that with James. Luke already has that ability to make threes. Ellington has the ability to make threes. You know, Willie is just an athletic young guy inside who can score, and we need to have a backup center, and so it was a good opportunity for us. So all of them, we feel like they will fit in, especially the way that coach wants to play.
Pat, with regard to Tyler Johnson, did you guys try to get out in front of that and go for a more balanced contract? And
yes.
If so, why did that not come together?
Impeccable with your word. I used that earlier, didn't I? You know, Tyler's a good kid. And so when he signed his offer sheet or agreed to an offer sheet with the Brooklyn, and obviously between the 1st of July and, you know, 7th, You know, you can talk to him about making him an offer, our kind of offer, which would be underneath that offer sheet for 4 years would be more normal. And or we could have made him a better one if we knew Dwyane wasn't going to be here. And they refused. And he said he wanted to keep his word, you know, with Brooklyn. And so I honor that. I get it. He wasn't going to agree to something and then come back to us and do something and say, well, it's off. You know, I mean, the kid's, you know, a great kid, and he's got great moral values. And so sometimes in this sport, you don't. He kept his word. And we matched it.
When Dwyane decided to go, how much did it kind of change, or in what ways did it change the vision you guys had for building out the rest of the team moving forward?
Well, let's look at it from a reality standpoint. If we didn't do anything and we just decided to sign everybody back and not do anything and just sign Hassan and Dwyane, and we'd have Goran and Dwyane, and we'd have Hassan. And Lou, you know, I mean, there's no way when Lou told us that he got $76 million or $72 million that, you know, that was – you know, that train just left the station. And when Joe got $22 million, you know, that train left the station. And so if we did nothing and just signed, then that's what we would have this year, plus our young guys. And then we would have a room, you know, exception. You must, I think it's almost a fiduciary responsibility on my part to keep us in the game of being able to have an audience with a Kevin Durant. I think it was a long shot for us, especially after CB went down. And so from that standpoint, I'll never ever not take, you know, an audience for the free agent who calls and says, we'd like to talk to you, or vice versa. And I think so when you're in that position, you have to do it. That didn't slow us down, but, you know, from the standpoint of, you know, where we are, you know, as a team, I feel good about, you know, what happened, you know, after the aftermath of Dwyane leaving.
Pat, you lost your two starting forwards from last year's playoff team. Was there any point where you either ask Lou or Joe Johnson to sort of remain on hold? And from someone who appreciates veteran leadership, how much does it hurt the team to see those two guys walk?
Lou was in. He was in. He wanted to stay here. He understood our dilemma, the fact that he didn't have bird rights and he was just a two-year guy, you know, contributed a little bit to our overall thinking, but still, there wasn't going to be enough for everybody. Now, you know, if a player decided to take some kind of an exception, then he gets his bird rights, and then next year you can be rewarded, and that's a whole other kind of player in the thought process. But he was in until his agent called and said, you know, 72 is a lot. And I really am happy for him. He's 31. He's going to go out to, I think, a great franchise. They're going to use him, I think, in the capacity of being – you know, a player, a producer, and also an educator of the young guys. And, you know, I think Joe was a long shot with us, you know, always. When we got Joe, we were very fortunate to get him because he wanted to come to Miami and play here because he had an opportunity to be in the playoffs and play. And so he did have an opportunity to get to two seventh games. And he got a great offer too. And once he got the offer, then both of them were gone. So we lost, you know, Lou, and we lost, you know, Joe. But I think the person that is going to benefit the most from this, and it's time to step up, is Justice Winslow. You know, he's capable of starting in this league, and you know, that is right now who we have slotted in there, and that is who I feel very comfortable with.
Pat, obviously, big roster makeover, but do you still feel this is a team that can contend for a playoff spot and should be in the playoffs next year?
When you look around the Eastern Conference and you take a look at, you know, who helped themselves and who didn't help themselves, you always, you know, Cleveland is obviously, you know, the class of the conference. You know, Horford, you know, going from, you know, from Atlanta, you know, to Boston, you know, it really, I think that helps them. They lose Sullinger. There's the possibility they might do something that can make them better. I don't know about, you know, with New York, with Derrick Rose, you know, going to New York, but with Joakim Noah, I think that's a great move for them to have those two players with Carmelo and with Porzingis, you know, I think, you know, that could be a team, you know, that could be different. I don't know how Atlanta's going to be with Howard now, you know, and he's a different kind of center than, you know, than Horford is. So I don't think there's any doubt that we can compete for a playoff spot. You know, I mean, you know, from that standpoint, you have to figure out and see who in the East, you know, really has what it takes to sort of be competitive. It takes 20 or 30 games, and you get a pretty good idea about where you are. But our plan is, yes, our plan is to always compete for a playoff spot. And I think we can do that. I don't think there's any doubt we can do it.
Pat, the run-up to 2010, I mean, it was obviously different. You guys planned a couple of years for it and got everything set up a certain way. But it obviously, it was invigorating, it seemed, for you, for Mickey, for the franchise, really, on a lot of levels. Do you kind of, are you already thinking about the possibility of a similar reinvigoration happening over the next 12 months because just because of the abilities you might have with the money that you should have next summer?
Well, that there's no guarantee that whatever money you can create next summer in the free agent market is going to bring in somebody. I think Kevin Durant is a pretty good example of a man who had an opportunity to make a choice, which is what you do in free agency, and he was true to what his criteria were. His main criteria was, if I go, I want to go to a team where I can win immediately. And he lived up to that. You know, and as hard as it was for him to move probably away from OKC, which is a formidable team, I read that Andre Iguodala said the other day that they were a championship team. And to make the change and go to Golden State, that's his choice. You know, that's what free agency is about. And that's what happened with Chris, and that's what happened with LeBron, you know, and that's what happened with Kevin. And I think you're going to probably see more and more of the superstars that might be with franchises for years, 4 or 5 years, and they're banging their head against the wall, and they get an opportunity to go somewhere where they think they can win now. I think you're going to see that happen more often. So as far as we're concerned, I'm always looking, you know, for that opportunity. I blow somebody's mic out here. And that's what we'll do again next year. Yeah, then we'll take a look at it. But there's no guarantee. You know, you sit down and talk with them, and then they're going to take a look at your roster, and they're going to take a look at everything, and they're going to talk to you about your future and your draft picks and everything. I can tell you a funny story about, maybe I shouldn't, but I can tell you a funny story about 2010. When we took the three of them in, we had 49.5 million. So we had 16.5 for each guy, which was the max deal. So you got it. You got it all. You got it all. We got it all. We got it for you. And they said, well, who do we have left? I said, we got Mario as a starting point guard, and we got Joel as your center. That's it. We have five guys. Well, we'd like to get Mike Miller. How can we get Mike Miller? I said, I can't get you Mike Miller. We can't get him. I don't have the money. Otherwise, I can't give you Mike Miller. And so we traded Michael Beasley to be able to get the money, but they had to go down to 15. That was their choice, you know. And then they said, oh, we want UD. Okay, well, I can't get UD, even though I wanted to get UD. And so it was, you know, that whole concept about, you know, bringing guys into room and on five-year deals. This is an interesting part of the July the 9th. They all agreed to come in on five-year deals, room only, so I didn't have to give up any assets. And then, you know, at the 11th hour, they all wanted the sixth year. And you know what that cost me and Andy. It cost us four picks. And I just said to him, I said, if you want the sixth year, because I know you're going to opt out after the fourth anyhow, but you're going to want the sixth year, I don't want any of you walking into my office and say, hey, can we get any young guys around here? Can we get some draft picks around here or do whatever it is? Because they were gone. And I don't know why I told you that story, but anyways. I always get amused by it because, you know, I watched our last draft pick that we gave for LeBron, like, get traded for, I think it went to Minnesota, ended up in Philly or somewhere, and he was playing in Cleveland, and we still owed it. And I told Andy when he goes to the CBA meetings, make sure that if you ever do a sign and trade and give up a draft pick for a player, and that player leaves before the draft pick goes to that team, that it automatically is like given back to you.
Pat, what was Chris Bosch's involvement in the negotiations with Wade, and how did he react once he found out that Wade wasn't coming back?
I don't know. He and Dwyane, I'm sure, were communicating, but I was not communicating with Chris at this time, you know, and I'm sure that, and I know that UD was communicating with him from that standpoint. It was a little bit difficult from a logistical standpoint. You know, Dwyane left somewhere at the end of June and was gone for a couple of weeks in Europe. And so, I mean, to be able to get an audience, you know, with him somewhere was hard. So everything was done through the agency. Everything was done through a myriad of agents and other voice pieces and stuff. It still doesn't mean that I shouldn't have gotten in a canoe and gone over there or made more of an effort, you know, to contact him. But there were people that were in touch with him that were close to him. Yeah.
Pat, you heard word that Eric Spoelstra is about to receive an extension. Can you address, has that been done or is that impending? And your thought on Eric in a little bit of a different role, now more developmental coach than maybe the stars that could sort of lead the way before?
You know, from a contractual standpoint, you know, and I don't know if we've made an announcement yet on it now, but we're working towards an extension that I do believe will, you know, come to fruition, not only with him, but also with his assistant coaches. And obviously, we want to put the staff together, and I do believe that Danny and Juwan and Chris will, you know, all be part of the bench staff from that standpoint. So, and Eric has been through this before, Ira, because his first 2 years after I retired, he had contending teams, competitive teams, playoff teams, but obviously, they weren't championship teams, and I thought he did, you know, a hell of a job, you know, at that time, and starting his coaching career with teams that were competitive and also playoff teams. So, and then he had the 4 years where I think he really earned his stripes as a head coach with four finals finishes and two world championships. And in the last couple of years, there's been some. You know, the rebuilding process, retooling to where we are today. He's got his work cut out for him. Welcome to being an NBA coach. It's not always going to be easy, and sometimes there's going to be other challenges. But I know one thing about him is that he is competitive. He's excited. He knows what the challenge is. He does love the guys that he has already developed. He's not a developmental coach. We have a developmental program in which he works very hard in improving from within. And so, you know, his philosophy as coach to me is bring him to me and I'll coach him. You know, that's it. That's the way it has to be right now. And he's very involved in the process all the time. Every single player that we talk about or sign, you know, he gives the nod, because I don't want to send him anybody that he doesn't want.